W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of Ajay and the Treasure of Thar by Varsha Shah, narrated by Susheel Kumar. Chapter 1. The sun radiated down onto the platform at Mumbai railway station. The tracks glowed hot silver, looking as if they were about to buckle and melt, and heat-exhausted early morning commuters stumbled towards their trains pressing bottles of ice water against their foreheads. Ajay wiped his brow with his handkerchief and leant against the concrete station pillar, only to jump forwards again as he felt it burn like a clothes iron against his skin. How was it early morning and already so hot? He looked down at the Faluda pink copies of the Mumbai Sun, the newspaper he and his friends had created, and bit his lip. At the age of 12 or thereabouts, he had spent his whole life on the railways after being abandoned on the platform. It had never been as hot as this. The only vendors making money were those selling glasses of sweet and sour lime water. No one was buying the Mumbai Sun. All anyone wanted was a way to keep cool. Ajay looked at the papers. The first rule of business was to give the customer what they wanted. A grin spread across his face. He picked up one of the papers and started folding. 10 minutes later, Ajay looked down with satisfaction, wiping the sweat from his brow. A pile of copies of the Mumbai Sun was spread all about him, each one a pink concertina fan. He called out, 10 rupees, 10 rupees for a special offer, 2-in-1, a folded fan with the latest news. Keep cool and read all about it in the morning edition of the Mumbai Sun. From his side came a sharp voice. Give me that. I am a businessman. Success! Joyfully, Ajay turned and held out one of the fans made out of the Mumbai Sun. The bald-headed businessman snatched it from him. And unlike street kids lazing around all day, I need a cool head to make deals that will bring in money. Ajay shaded his eyes from the blazing sun with his hand. You are welcome, sir. You now hold in your hand a copy of the Mumbai Sun, and owe me just 10 rupees. A bargain for a newspaper that has taken down a crook, reported a moon landing, and has been edited. Here Ajay gave a modest cough. By the humble young man standing before you. The bald-headed businessman stopped fanning his face with the Mumbai Sun, bent down and looked at Ajay with a crafty glint in his eye. Owe you? Ah! But how can I be expected to pay for something that is not in pristine condition? This newspaper has been folded. You cannot expect me to pay for that. Not unless... The businessman's eyes became filled with mist as he looked into the distance. You have a story about the auction Mr. Jute is holding of his collection of marvelous objects. I would give my life to buy his collection. Imagine how envious people would be when they came to my home and saw my riches. Ajay felt his heart sink. No one, apart from other billionaires, could get tickets to Mr. Jute's auction. Even the location of it was top secret, and yet it was all that anyone could dream or talk about. Ajay lowered his voice dramatically and said in a conspiratorial whisper, Kind sir, I don't have a ticket to the auction. He took a deep breath. But I do have a piece of India's greatest treasures in pristine condition, and therefore valuable beyond all measure. If Mr. Jude knew about it, I guarantee even he would be jealous. The bald-headed businessman's eyes widened. You own a piece of India's greatest treasures, Ajay nodded. One definitely worthy enough to get into Mr. Jute's auction, he improvised. I found it, he added for good measure. Fallen off the back of a truck? The businessman's eyes gleamed. No, don't tell me. Finders, keepers and all that. He bent down, almost dropping the folded Mumbai Sun in his excitement at his plan. Look, your sort can't keep precious objects safe. Sell it to me instead. 5 rupees should be sufficient for you. After all, anything much more than that, and I would have to alert the police. And they don't take kindly to railway kids. Ajay stared at him for a moment and held out his left hand. 10 rupees. Glancing around to check no one was looking and whipping out his wallet, the businessman handed over the money. Tucking the 10 rupees safely into his pocket, Ajay carefully took the precious object out. The businessman, who had been rubbing his hands with glee, stopped. What's this? Ajay smiled at him.
A seed.
What? The businessman spluttered. A seed? But where's the gold? The treasure? At Ajay's blank look. Why, you little... Ajay smiled at the businessman, cutting his, no doubt grateful thanks mid-flow.
You are welcome, sir. It is a seed from a jackfruit tree in the Hanging Gardens. Jackfruit trees are among India's greatest treasures. You don't need to thank me. But your train, sir, you'd better hurry if you want to catch it.
The bald-headed businessman turned bright like a jackfruit himself. Then seeing the train pulling out of the station, he threw the seed down in front of Ajay and ran to get his seat. As the train left, with the businessman on it, he waved a clenched fist at Ajay. Ajay waved back at him, picked up the seed, precious beyond all measure, and tucked it carefully away in his pocket alongside the businessman's 10-rupee note. Despite the heat, it was going to be a good day. And afterwards, when he had sold all his papers to celebrate, Ajay would return to the shade of the Hanging Gardens, eat another dripping gold jackfruit, and plant the seed in the sun-cracked earth. There it would grow, a wonderful, fruit-filled, precious, priceless, one-of-a-kind tree. Ajay picked up 3 copies of the Mumbai Sun in each hand and fanned himself cool, licking his lips, dreaming of a rain of deliciously golden fruit. Chapter 2. Ajay made his way back to the station from the Hanging Gardens, wilting like one of the dying and withered plants he had just seen. He was worried. The heat that was grinding everything in Mumbai to a halt had got worse throughout the day. And the next edition of the Mumbai Sun, the finest newspaper in Mumbai, was in trouble because of more than just the heat. He, Ajay, editor extraordinaire, had run out of news. The last 5 editions of the Mumbai Sun had gone from the hot Mumbai Sun, the hotter Mumbai Sun, the hottest Mumbai Sun, the extra hottest Mumbai Sun, to now the extra, extra hottest Mumbai Sun. Ajay had been very proud of the titles. But even he had to admit that the Mumbai Sun was now sounding more like chili pepper sauce than a newspaper. And if he did not find another story soon, the once mighty paper would soon be pink dust. As he came up to the platform, Ajay overheard a commuter dressed in a sari talking excitedly to another commuter who was dressed in linen trousers and a short silk blouse.
Have you read it?
What?
The newest and finest newspaper in Mumbai. You really must read it. It will change your view of Mumbai completely. I don't now read anything else. I have a copy with me. It's called the...
Ajay cheered up. He puffed out his chest. Perhaps things weren't so bad after all. The Mumbai Sun still had readers. It could still bring voice to the voiceless. It could still...
Happy paper,
said the commuter in the sari, bringing out a bright, shiny yellow newspaper with a flourish.
The what?
Ajay's chest deflated like a popped balloon. The commuter's friend shrugged loftily.
No, and I don't intend to. I've made the difficult decision not to read newspapers anymore. Reading about poor people makes me feel uncomfortable, especially in this heat. It's so much better to ignore all the unhappiness in the world and concentrate on what I can control and what makes me happy. But that's just it, said the commuter, opening up the bright pages of the happy paper. There is nothing uncomfortable in the happy paper. It just tells you how you can spend your money, how great billionaires like Mr. Jute are, and how everything is getting better. Ajay's eyes widened. All this worry about climate change, for example, the commuter continued. Sounding very happy indeed, thought Ajay. The happy paper says we have to be impartial and look at both sides. If someone argues that Mumbai is getting hotter, there will be someone else who argues it is not. Both points of view are equal. Ajay gaped. That made no sense. Surely if one person told the truth and another told a lie, the truth wasn't somewhere in between. And also, had the happy paper not heard of thermometers? Ajay was about to explain the invention to the commuter in a great amount of detail when a train chugged and whistled its way into the station. The doors lurched open and the commuter and the friend hurried to get in, leaving Ajay standing on the platform lost and confused. Ajay! Ajay turned and saw his friend Vinod, one of the older railway kids. Tall, lanky, gentle and quiet, waving to him to come over to where he was sitting next to a bubbling pot over a canister flame. Beside Vinod was their friend Jay, also about 15, the slum kid cricketer, leaning against one of the steps. Try some Kashmiri tea, said Vinod as Ajay came over pouring dusty pink tea from the pot to a clay mug. I've been practicing the recipe. It's... Have you heard of the happy paper? Vinod froze, and some of the tea splashed from the pot, missed the mug and fell to the ground. He and Jay exchanged a look over Ajay's head. Ajay caught the look. You have? How could you not tell me? He said, outraged. Vinod was quiet. He continued to pour more tea into the mug. The rich flavour of cardamom went up Ajay's nose, making him sneeze. We were going to, started Vinod. But we didn't want to worry you, said Jay. Worry me, said Ajay, taking the tea from Vinod despite his annoyance. We are the Mumbai Sun. We can easily beat this new paper. It won't be that easy, Ajay, said Jay quietly, his gold eyes dark. It's not like other papers. No one outside the station is reading the Mumbai Sun anymore. That stopped Ajay in his tracks. How was that possible? The pink Kashmiri tea sloshed around his mug. This new paper's motto is opinions are great, Jay continued quietly. People like it. More than ours, I think. A pit opened in Ajay's stomach. He took a gulp of the hot, fragrant pink tea to steady himself and rallied. We need to show them that they're wrong. Another story, that's all we need. The readers will rush back, he said brightly. Jay, any cricket news? Jay shook his head, his hair falling into his eyes. All matches have been cancelled because of the heat, he said bitterly, spinning his cricket bat on the ground with the force of a drill. Taking away his ability to play cricket had left Jay jittery and exhausted. It had been his one outlet, the one place he used to feel safe. Ajay bit his lip, raging helplessly at the weather that was doing what the worst politicians had so far failed to do to those they hated for no reason. Cruelly prevent Jay from playing a sport he loved. And without cricket, what news was left? If the Mumbai Sun was going to win back readers, it needed a story bigger than Godzilla, bigger than Everest, bigger than Jupiter. But the only story that was as big as that was the collection of marvelous objects. He looked up. Vinod looked at him, realization dawning, and shook his head. Ajay, it's not possible to get a ticket to the auction. You know that. We don't need a ticket, said Ajay, starry-eyed. There's another way to get the story.
Chapter 3. Why had he not thought of it before? Ajay was beside himself with excitement. The whole of Mumbai knew that Mr. Jute was holding an exclusive, by invitation only, secret party at his apartment tonight. It would be Mr. Jute's last chance to show off items from his exclusive collection of marvelous objects before the objects were sold at the auction. So, if Ajay and his friends got access to the party, they would get to see and write about the objects too. Ajay's heart beat wildly. The collection was rumored to contain glowing blood-red rubies, the size of fists, silk tapestries so fine they shimmered at every breath, statues carved from sparkling blue and white veined marble. Only the cream of Mumbai society had ever seen them. If Ajay could get access to the party, he would have the story of the year. And, better yet, he would be able to show the readers of the Mumbai Sun some of the most beautiful examples of craftsmanship in the world. The happy paper had no chance. Forget it, Jay said quickly. Ajay was wrenched from his thoughts. Jay's right, said Vinod. There's no way the Mumbai Sun is getting access to the party. We've tried before, remember? Ajay was forced to face facts for a moment. Mr. Jute, despite being the nicest billionaire in Mumbai, had again and again turned down Ajay's requests for an interview, even when they had been written carefully out on the finest Faluda pink paper in swirling letters using Ajay's mother's black and gold fountain pen. Only the richest and most powerful people in the world get to go to Mr. Jute's parties, said Jay, just in case Ajay had missed the point. Ajay frowned. Jay and Vinod were right, but he had to do something. The Mumbai Sun needed this story if it was to survive. How could he get access? It wasn't as if tickets to exclusive parties in Mumbai just dropped into people's laps. And that was just it. Ajay realized with dampening spirits, it wasn't just a ticket to the auction that was impossible to get hold of. Even a ticket to the party was too much to ask for. To get some stories, you had to be part of the inner circle. And being a railway kid meant that you never could be. So what was left? It wasn't as if great stories were just going to walk in, tug on your arm and announce themselves. Ajay felt a small pull on his arm. Excuse me, kind sir. I am looking for the editor of the Mumbai Sun. Do you know where I might find him? Chapter 4. Ajay jumped, then smiled. All was not lost. A fan, perhaps they wanted his autograph. He had been practicing scrawling it before he went to sleep each night. It had to look good. He prepared his most serious look and, turning around, spoke slowly and gravely. I am Ajay, editor of the Mumbai Sun. My pronouns are he, him. I am very pleased to make your acquaintance. He held out his hand, blinked, and looked down. In front of him was a young child of about 7 years old, wearing shorts, a neatly ironed shirt and glasses, who passed Ajay a note on stiff paper that said, Please look after my grandson, Kai. The boy would have looked altogether very serious and grave if it weren't for his hair, which was swept up as though a cow had just gone up to him and licked it. My name is Kai. I'm my grandmother's grandson, he reaffirmed. Are you really you? He asked Ajay. His eyes were wide. Of course I'm me, said Ajay with confidence. Kai smiled, looking relieved. That's good. You see, my grandmother sent me here to meet you. Now that we've met, you have to come with me. And with that, Kai turned and, picking up the heavy suitcase that looked like it was almost his size, started walking. Wait, Ajay cried, quickly taking out his notebook and his mother's pen and chasing after him. Where are we going? To Jodhpur, said Kai, matter-of-factly. Ajay stopped in his tracks. Jodhpur? But that's in Rajasthan.
Yes, it's our first stop and a very long way away. That's why we have to hurry.
Guy was still walking.
Stop! Ajay cried.
Guy stopped and turned around. He looked like he was gathering his strength. Now that Ajay could take a closer look at him, he saw that the frames of Guy's glasses were made of thin wire, one of his shoes had a flapping sole, and that anxiety was rippling under Guy's look of intense determination.
Will you help me or not?
Guy asked, looking from Ajay to Jai and Vinod, who had now caught up, and back to Ajay again. Guy's tone was defiant, but Ajay could see his lip tremble.
Of course we will, said Ajay.
When somebody needed help, you helped them. And then, suddenly realizing that he needed more information,
but what with?
Guy motioned to the three of them to form a close circle around him. Without question, drawn in by his intense look, they did so. The evening sun fell upon him in waves as he took off his glasses, wiped them, and put them on again. Then he coughed and began to speak in the tones of a British presenter Ajay had seen on the nature documentaries he had become addicted to on the station TV.
I have travelled for many moons through jungles and mountains.
Jungles and mountains, Vinod said, astonished.
Where?
Guy looked at him and frowned.
Don't interrupt. You'll spoil the story.
Vinod subsided.
Guy coughed. I have travelled for many moons through jungles and mountains to get to you. Me and my grandmother are the last guardians of the treasure of Thar.
Ajay and Vinod looked at each other. Guy, unperturbed, continued.
The site of the treasure was hidden by my great-great-great-grandparents to keep it from being stolen by the British whilst they were busy colonizing India. We have kept the map of its location safe for centuries. Now looters, employed by someone using the seal of a four-headed snake, know of the existence of the treasure and are trying to find us and where it is hidden. My grandmother struggles to move and sent me as a messenger to seek your help. She read a copy of the Mumbai Sun. She believes that you are warriors worthy of this sacred quest. To discover the secret of the map that will lead to the exact location of the treasure, find the ancient treasure, and then defend it with your lives. In the golden rays of sunlight, Guy looked very fierce as he said the last words.
Is this a joke? Vinod whispered so that only Ajay could hear. Ajay didn't answer. He was watching transfixed as Guy, with great ceremony, clicked open his suitcase and took out the only thing in it. An ancient, tattered book with a soft greyish-green cover, held together with a string with gold lettering that spelt The Traveller's Companion to Thar. Guy then gently shook the book so that from the spine slid out a silver metal tube with a screw-top lid. He opened the tube with infinite care and took out the scrolled piece of paper inside. A map. Ajay's eyes widened. He loved maps. Maps of the world, maps of India, real maps, walking maps, tourist maps, road maps, and, best of all, magical maps of fantastic lands that he would sometimes find drawn in the front of books. And this one was beautiful. Inked on thick sepia-tinted paper, with a compass rose etched at the bottom and patterns and symbols at the top, and drawings of dragons flying across it, the map showed Jaisalmer fort on one side and the Thar desert on the other. And there, marked with a red cross in the southwest corner of the vast desert, were inscribed the words, The Treasure of Thar.
It can't be real, can it? It has to be a fake.
Vinod exclaimed, earning himself a furious glare from Kai. Ajay's eyes glowed. A treasure map. He gently took the map from Guy and stared at it. It was the miracle he was hoping for. No, he corrected himself. Not miracle. Miracles. A treasure map and the key to getting in to see Mr. Jute's collection of marvelous objects. Chapter 5. Ajay, Saif, Yasmin and Kai were shooting upwards to Mr. Jute's apartment in a marble lift. On receipt of Ajay's note, delivered by a butler from the front door, setting out the story of the Guardians and Kai's treasure map, Mr. Jute had sent back down an invitation to his party. Saif, apprentice engineer, about 12 and also a railway kid, was busy breathing on one of the lift walls, polishing it with his sleeve to better see his reflection, and beaming at the result. Kai's small face, however, was strained. His reflection showed he was gripping so tightly onto the suitcase, his knuckles were white. "Are you sure this is a good idea?" said Yasmin, who was standing straight as an arrow next to Ajay. She was also 12, illustrator for the Mumbai Sun and Ajay's best friend. Her emerald eyes narrowed as she frowned. "Kai's trusting us to keep his map safe." "Of course," Ajay said. Once he got Mr. Jute's permission to tell the story of his collection, the happy paper would have no chance. Seeing that, Yasmin still looked concerned. He added breezily, "Mr. Jute is the nicest billionaire in Mumbai. He knows everything about antiques. Who better to tell us if the map is real or not? And if it is real, he'll help us decode its treasure so that it might lead us to the exact location of the treasure." Yasmin looked at him piercingly. "So, nothing to do with getting a story." Ajay was saved from replying by the lift doors opening. For a moment he was stunned into silence. "The party," he breathed. "What a party!" The doors of the lift had opened into a chilly, chandeliered silvery room with accents of black and turquoise velvet. Jazz music mingled with the sound of clinking glasses and the room smelt of minerals and ice. People were milling around in silk suits, slithery cocktail dresses splashed with geometrical designs, and saris edged with deep blue sapphires, the depth and colour of the ocean. His blood thrumming and shivering in the suddenly chill air, Ajay took out his notebook and his mother's fountain pen. "May I put your bag in the cloakroom?" said a cool voice. A tall, elegant attendant had approached Kai. Kai shrank away, putting his body in front of the suitcase. "I know something about this," Saif said confidently. He pushed past Ajay to stand next to Kai and shook his head at the attendant with an air of hard-earned wisdom. "No, you may not. Suitcases, even those of apprentice engineers, can get stolen. It is very dangerous to let them out of your sight." The attendant arched an eyebrow. As Saif dealt with the attendant, Ajay looked around. He needed to find Mr. Jute. The crowd was biggest to his right. "Saif, Yasmin, stay here and find out about the collection. Kai, you come with me." And with that, Ajay and Kai were off, making their way as nonchalantly as they could past tall fluted marble pillars covered in sheets of black velvet. Holding on to Kai's hand, Ajay pushed his way through the crowd, helped by the corners of Kai's suitcase, until at last it opened up in front of a person sitting casually on a stool with a smile. Mr. Jute. Ajay, like everyone in Mumbai, had seen countless photos of the billionaire. There was the one of him in a biscuit-coloured safari suit, holding a darkly glittering jade mask. The one of him sitting like a mystic on top of a craggy, sun-shadowed mountain, looking out onto emerald moss-covered ruins, and the one of him underwater in a wetsuit and snorkel, swimming beside a towering shipwreck, giving a big thumbs up. But none of those photos had quite captured the glowing energy that seemed to emanate from him. He sat there, mid-flow, enthralling the audience in his soft voice that sounded like rich coffee dripping into a mug. And then I saw it, in the dead of night, by the light of a flickering candle, Tutankhamun's tomb, full of mystery and wonder, and on it inscribed a curse on those who dare to disturb it. There were murmurs of oohs and ahs from the crowd. Ajay could see it now. The warm shadows cast by the gold flame, the coppery script, a snake slipping out of sight. "But you couldn't have.
There is no curse inscribed on the tomb. It was a made-up story. Guy's voice piped up, sounding very puzzled. If Guy had thrown a stink bomb into the middle of the crowd, it would have had less of an effect. The crowd recoiled as one. "Who is that?" said Mrs. Preeti, a TV presenter Ajay recognized wearing a lacy blue sari. "Vermin," answered someone from the crowd. "How dare they come here and interrupt? Security!" Mr. Jute remained relaxed, a slight twitch of the mouth, the only indication that he had heard. He turned to the crowd and gestured for quiet, his brown eyes warm.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.